what I'd like to do with the time remaining today is to set the groundwork for doing the 11-step exercise. You have three handouts. The first one is called the AA 4 Standards in the Oxford Group for Absolutes. Go ahead and pull that one out. Keep in mind that a good portion of what we have in our big book and the principles that we have today were taken from the Oxford Group, which the early AA members participated. That's where AA got its start. Got its start was in the Oxford Group, and then eventually the AA members left the Oxford Group and started their own organization, later to be known as Alcoholics Anonymous. And this is what they discovered. See, in the big book, we have what are called the four standards. At the bottom of the page, these are listed on page 67 and page 84. The opposite of those are called the four absolutes, which the early AA members obtained from the Oxford Group. They are honesty, purity, unselfish, and love. In other words, the opposite of selfish is unselfish. The opposite of dishonesty is honesty. The opposite of resentment is purity, and the opposite of fear is love. Now, the guidance I receive in meditation that is selfish, dishonest, resentful, or fearful is clearly guidance that came from me. Guidance that I receive in meditation, which is unselfish, honest, pure, and loving, I can be assured came from God. And I'm going to walk you through a process that they use early on in AA. First, I'd like to talk just briefly about meditation. Keep in mind what the authors are saying in Step 11. Step 11 does not say, sought through prayer to improve our conscious contact. It says, sought through prayer and meditation. Consider that meditation is simply listening. The thing I've discovered about meditation is that you cannot do it wrong and you do not need to do it right. What works for one person may not work for another. You need to find a way that works for you. What's most important is that you're willing to try it and that you're willing to attempt listening. So here's what prayer without meditation is like. Let's say my friend Rusty here calls me up and invites me to a party to his house. I said, great, I'll be right over. And I hang up before I get directions on how to get there. I'm not going to know which way to go. That's what prayer without meditation is like. I've had that experience in these rooms, not meditating and only praying. Now, my understanding of a relationship is that it involves two-way communication. That means there's talking and there's listening. So if there's talking and no listening, is that a relationship? No. So you see, I can't really have a relationship with God if all I'm doing is praying. I did that. Yeah, I'll just thank God in the morning, you know, or ask Him to keep me sober at night, thanking for keeping me sober. That's not a relationship. In order for me to have a relationship with my friend Diane here, it's necessary that I talk and then I listen. That's called two-way communication. So you see, if I'm not practicing meditation in addition to the prayer, a couple of things are not going to happen. Number one, I'm not going to improve my relationship, nor am I going to receive the knowledge of His will, nor am I going to receive the power to carry it out. So see, if all I'm doing is praying, I'm still operating on self-will. I make it sound like I'm living a spiritual way of life, but I'm really not. Okay, there's one called meditation. Please pull out that handout. The top of it is entitled Meditation. Meditation. If I am not receiving thoughts when I listen, the fault is not God's. Usually it is because there is something I will not do. These are typically some of the reasons we are blocked during meditation and we're not hearing guidance. Keep in mind that guidance can come in the form of an intuitive thought. Here's one. Something wrong in my life that I will not face and make right. Maybe there's something I'm not willing to face. a habit or indulgence I will not give up. Now, I'm not giving that thing up. It may block me. A person I will not forget. I can't forgive them. Look what they did to me. They caused me more harm than I caused them. Guaranteed to block you. A wrong relationship in my life I will not give up. Yeah, but it's my responsibility to take care of that daughter or that son of mine. To an extent. I can't leave her. I love her too much. Can't leave him. I love him too. He needs me. A restitution I will not make. I'm not paying that money back. I don't need to. Something God has already told me to do that I will not obey. Here's a common experience I've had numerous times. I take something to meditation, and I don't like the guidance I receive. So I do one of two things. I go out and I do some poll taking. And I start asking for other people's feedback. Along the way, I'm eventually going to find somebody to endorse what I want to do. The other response I have is, I think I need to meditate on that some more. I've already received the guidance. I just don't want to do it. For example, on this, a restitution I will not make. I refuse to make that restitution, and I justify why I'm not making that amend. For example, I remember in early sobriety, there was this stereo I wanted to buy. I needed to buy this kick-ass stereo for my apartment. And I had not made some major financial amends. And that's when my sponsor pointed out to me, is that your money you're spending? Oh, yeah, that's my money. I earned it. Really? Don't you owe those people X amount of dollars? Well, yeah. Then you know whose money you're spending? Theirs? Yes, I was spending their money. It was their money, not mine. It took a while for that one to register. Okay, these are some of the things that can block you in meditation. Okay, basically this is what the early AA members did. Be aware that in the 40s, the early AA members, especially in the Cleveland and Akron area, did what they called daily written meditation. They did it daily. They prayed and they meditated. After meditating, they pulled out pencil and paper and wrote down all the guidance that they received. No editing. Write it all down. And then they took those thoughts, that guidance, and they tested it against the four absolutes. See, if it's honest, pure, loving, and unselfish, I can be assured that it came from God. Keeping in mind that not everything I hear in meditation comes from God. So what this process will do for you is it will clearly identify the origin of your guidance. So they would take the four absolutes and test it against the guidance. This way they could be assured which guidance came from God and which came from them. Here are some examples on this piece of paper, on this handout. Let's assume that this is the guidance you received in your meditation. Give them a piece of my mind. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? No, that came from me. Next one, be patient with others today. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? Yes, that came from God. I need to avoid that person today. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? No. Be kind to others today. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? Yes, that came from God. Accept others as they are. Is that honest, pure, loving, and unselfish? Yes. So here we can be assured which guidance came from me and which came from God. This is what I'm asking you to do. Meditate after you pray. That means listen. All the guidance that comes to you, write it down on paper. Test the guidance against the four absolutes. And though I understand this is a private matter, personal to you in your two-way communication with God, and be willing to share with us the guidance that you received from God, not the guidance you received from you. So what you do is you test it against the four absolutes, cross off the guidance that came from you. The purpose of doing this is to show you that God does exist and that he does communicate to us during meditation. Those of you that are willing to complete this exercise will be a great example to those in this room that are still doubtful that God communicates to us through meditation. There are a lot of books out there that you can read on meditation. There's one book I would recommend that you get for meditation, and it's a book that has the word meditation in it. If it says meditation, get it. If you don't have information on meditation, it's information that you don't have. There's no right way, there's no wrong way to do this. You have to find a way that works for you. What I did in the beginning was I used the Serenity Prayer for a period of time. I used the 12 steps. In other words, I would recite all 12 steps in my head so I could get quiet. You can try using breathing exercises or simply focusing on your breathing. Go through a process where you're relaxing the entire body, you know, where you're starting at the top of your head and you're telling yourself, I'm okay, I'm going to relax my head, my neck, my shoulders, my chest, my stomach, etc., etc. Whatever works for you. Personally, I like to have a quiet place. When I do my meditation, I go a place where there's no phones and there's no TV and there's no one knocking on the door. And I go through my prayers and I go through this process of attempting to become quiet and still. In the beginning, it was real difficult. There was a lot of chatter going on in my head. The worst thing we can do during meditation is trying to stop it. Let it happen. Don't try to control the chatter in your head.